to put the problem very clearly, you destroy human life in order to save human lives. That puts the finger on the problem in a sort of brutal way, because you cannot deny that you destroy the blastocyst. So in a sense, you destroy a potential human life.
The status of humanity and human life has been the subject of thought and debate and discussion for millennia, really. Our philosophical approaches owe a lot to Aristotle and Aquinas, and they recognised that there was something special about the human being, but they weren't sure when that specialness or when the personhood came into being.
Few would deny the potential for medical research from research into embryonic and adult stem cells. But the big ethical question is, should we be using embryos to do this? What is the moral status of the early human embryo? Is it fully a person or what?
The Catholic Church, when it looks at embryonic stem cell research, sees really the same issues in place as there are in abortion. It's all about when life begins and what protection we offer to all human beings. We can never set aside a subset of humanity and say they are not deserving of protection.
The Islamic perspectives of the status of the embryo, I would think we could recognize four different stages. Firstly, the embryo outside the womb, the embryo when it's implanted into the womb, then a gestation of 6 to 8 weeks when the fetus is fully formed, and finally, most importantly, is 120 days after conception when ensoulment takes place, and that is a very important milestone.
For some people, the early embryo has no status, and it is a matter of duty that you should be doing the research in order to save human life. The scales weigh very heavily on one side. The opposite position is that, in a sense, there is no balance at all, because you cannot do research on what is seen as being a human being. In between these two, there is a question of balance. How far would you be justified in destroying what could be a human being if you created the right conditions for the embryo to be implanted, but you nonetheless decide to do research on it instead? What justifies research?
The sanctity of life and the protection of the embryo is not the only values. Those who suffer from incurable diseases, they also have interests that need to be looked after, and there is a moral obligation to cure diseases, to relieve suffering, and to restore health.
I have Parkinson's disease, and that may one day be treatable by the applications of stem cell research. And I think that the broader issue is about getting society into a better, more healthy perspective, allowing people to live their full lives in their families with the benefit of good medicine, wherever that may come from. Everything changes when somebody has one of these disorders. It's not just the patient that is suffering, but the whole family gets drawn into the problem as well. And I think it's incumbent upon us to try and find a solution that benefits the patient and the wider family as well.
If we consider the suffering of people who have diabetes, Parkinson, Alzheimer, and a few other yet so far incurable diseases, then especially diabetes is a large group.
These are diseases that almost everybody knows somebody who suffers from that. So there is a big potential to actually cure disease that's never been curable in the past.
We can't ever find something that can counterbalance the direct killing of a life. And when we destroy an embryo to get embryonic stem cells, that's exactly what we do. So that is an absolute. We must protect all life.
I know from my own experience of becoming disabled that it's very easy to look at a situation through one set of spectacles. Then when you're given another set of spectacles to wear, seeing the whole thing completely differently. We would pay a price of working on some human embryos, but the benefit would come back in the treatment of society itself. But there's always a cost. And whatever scientists want to do, I think it's much easier if we accept there is a cost and get on with it in a carefully regulated context.
While the question of how we begin as a human being and how we develop is an old issue, it was only when embryos became available outside the womb that the present questions became asked. And that's what prompted the government to set up the Warnock Committee in the 1980s, which looked in considerable detail at the moral and ethical issues surrounding the human embryo and to what extent research might or might not be permitted.
Single-celled embryos, most of these, most of our fertilised embryos, don't end up as babies at all. They're lost at a very, very early stage, before you would even notice that you were pregnant. Those embryos that are fertilised and do go on to become babies may not become just one baby, but two or more. They could be identical twins or triplets. So what we have at the beginning of the embryonic development, fertilisation, is something that could be no one, two or more babies. So I think it's very difficult to call that a person.
The main conclusion of the Warnock Committee was that while the human embryo deserves greater respect than that generally accorded to human tissues, it should not necessarily be given respect due to actual persons until about 14 days. And after 14 days, the so-called primitive streak begins, where here is the beginning of sentience, consciousness, the beginning of organs, and beyond this point, one should not therefore research. The majority view was that you could use surplus embryos from IVF treatments to do research.
During in vitro fertilisation, the eggs are fertilised in a dish, and there they can develop to what's called the blastocyst stage. They can't develop into a baby without being transferred into a woman's body and then implanted in the womb. Embryonic stem cells are made from these early blastocysts, which consist of around 100 to 200 cells, and they're no bigger than a grain of sand.
During the in vitro fertilization procedures, there are always a number of extra embryos which are not implanted into the mother and are actually kept frozen in special freezers. So for example, in many countries there are many thousand, even 30 or 50,000 overexceeding embryos which are kept in these freezers, and basically they are kept there forever and ever without any, let's say, use.
You have, on the one hand, an embryo which would otherwise be thrown away or stored for indefinitely. And on the other hand, people who almost everybody knows who suffer from really debilitating and serious diseases. So for me, that's a big argument in favour of using embryonic stem cells.
I mean, there's also the danger of hype, that we talk as if the therapy was almost there, and I think there's a long way to go before we have a functioning therapy. I mean, it's one thing to be able to grow a dopamine-producing cell, and another thing to implant it in the brain of a patient suffering from Parkinson in such a way that it is safe, that it grows, and that it cures the disease.
We have been working with Parkinson's disease, among other neurological diseases, for quite many years. And what we have done, starting almost 20 years ago now, is an experiment or experiments using human fetal tissue. They can produce dopamine, and you can have functional effects and improve patients.
in some patients with quite dramatic improvement. And this is some kind of proof of concept studies, which of course are promising or form a quite promising basis for the stem cell therapies. And there are many attempts now to generate large numbers of dopamine neurons from stem cells to transplant in Parkinson's patients.
You could see huge developments and improvements. Not quickly, it's not going to happen next week, but there's a long-term benefit that I think will be available for people with Parkinson's disease, like I have.
And what we are doing now is to prepare for the next step, namely to develop a stem cell-based therapy, which I think is several years ahead, because we don't really know what is the best stem cell source to produce dopamine yet.
One other thing that is problematic about the debate is that it focuses so much on the status of the embryo and the rights of the embryo, and so little on the needs of the patients, and so little on the access to the treatments and the justice question, and who pays and who benefits. And then, of course, there are questions that have to do with commercialization and intellectual property rights, patentability of stem cells and stem cell lines. So there's a variety of issues that need to be discussed, and need to be discussed early, I think.
When I look at the legislation in Europe, for example, there are some countries which forbid embryonic stem cell research, but they allow abortion and they allow contraceptive pills, for example. And I think that ethics should strive to be consistent.
Well, in Italy, abortion is allowed, so it is not clear, I mean, why, I mean, there should be so much emphasis on embryonic stem cells. We do not understand exactly, I mean, why, I mean, the law should be so restrictive. This is creating, anyway, a sort of public fear, even within the scientific community, to the point that there are very few groups in Italy that are working on human embryonic stem cells. To my knowledge, there are only three groups. Although there are groups that I know are working, let's say, on embryonic stem cells, but in a more hidden way. They don't want to say that openly and publicly. And I think this is a big damage that one could do to science, because in this way, science is not open, it's not free, I mean, definitely this is influencing the development of science and also the perception of science.
The countries which have a restrictive point of view towards embryonic stem cell research, how will they react if and when the countries which have a permissive legislation will finally find the possible treatments for the patients? They should not be able to forbid their patients from using those therapies, because the patients should have the freedom to choose where they want to be treated and what kind of treatment they want to receive.
The UK regulatory framework and the Human Fertilisation and Embryology Act has worked very hard to take on board all of these issues, not just the original ones, but the new ones raised by stem cells and cloning. And what you've got is a regulatory framework respected across the world, but also challenged, because for many it goes too far. So if you're a scientist watching this, just simply having the law allowing you to do things isn't the only question you should be asking yourself. Ethically, what should I do? Should I be saying yes to cloned embryos or creating embryos, even if the law allows it? These are not questions that are uncontroversial.
Regulation, we believe, does not absolve people from the activities they pursue. You know, I think they really have to think through the issues themselves and think, is what I am doing ethical? Is it good? It may seem like a good objective I have in mind, but am I using good means?
Sometimes these discussions become so theoretical there are sitting 100 healthy people discussing the ethical aspects of this, of stem cell research and doing. When you see these patients who have severe diseases, I've seen patients who come to me when they're relatively young with minor signs, and you see this chronic degeneration, and that within a period of 10 years or even shorter, they are just cannot move, they cannot, they are just dying. So if this would help the patients, I think that on balance, it is justified to use the stem cells.
But you need to think about these issues for yourself and take personal responsibility, because when we talk about public morality, when we talk about public spending, then of course we cannot avoid talking about consequences, and the consequences are always consequences for someone. So what would be the consequences of this, that, or the other option for your children, their children, and grandchildren? So what sort of world would you want to hand over to them? Think about that and then make up your mind.
Speaking as a gynecologist and a Muslim, I would personally advocate the use of stem cell technology research, provided that the embryos are obtained according to the ethics of Sharia law.
I'm a Catholic. I was always brought up to respect life from the very moment that it was created, and stem cell research really in my eyes is the ending of a human being's life, and that's always wrong.
I'd like to see stem cell research provide some sort of solution that would be a full-time cure and healing for people with Parkinson's disease.
Embryonic stem cells, they know how to do basically every single cell type of the body organism. So all secrets are there. We have just to discover them.
We are now talking about therapies that could become useful treatments for patients where we have very little to offer.
My personal point of view is that it is the patient's voice that should be heard, and they should be really involved in the decision-making.
I would be very unhappy about the idea of simply creating an embryo for stem cells. It seems to be too instrumental. But to use one that is going to be destroyed because it's no longer needed in an IVF treatment seems appropriate.
I'm both a Christian and a scientist, and I think that weighing up the potential benefits of embryonic stem cell research against the idea that single-celled embryos are not really equivalent to a person with the same rights as an adult or even a baby, then I think that embryonic stem cell research is justified.